Hi, and welcome back to Type 1 Diabetes Explained. CGMs are a commonplace item in diabetes treatment, but how do they work? Today, we will take a closer look at how CGMs are made and how they work. The transmitter and receiver are fairly simple, with similar technology to what is found in cell phones. So we will focus on the CGM sensors. To understand how they are made, let's first look at how they work. Despite the many differences, CGMs and blood glucose meters work in surprisingly similar ways. Both use an enzyme called glucose oxidase. This enzyme converts the glucose in the body into hydrogen peroxide. The hydrogen peroxide then reacts with the metals inside the sensor or the test strip, creating an electrical charge, which travels to a computer chip where it is then translated into blood glucose levels. To have a meter test strip, all that you need is a glucose oxidase and the metal. However, with the CGM, you also need several other chemicals to help protect the glucose oxidase and metal from the immune system of the body that it is in. The first step in manufacturing a CGM sensor is to make sure that everybody and everything is sterile in the manufacturing plant. Since parts of the sensor will be going into patients' bodies, everybody must be wearing sterile gowns, shoes, hair covers, and have thoroughly washed their hands before they can begin making a CGM sensor. The next step is to coat the metal, which is usually platinum, with the glucose oxidase. Then, the metal and the glucose oxidase are coated with chemicals that will protect it from attacks by the immune system. These chemicals are currently the limiting factors in CGMs. The immune system is always trying to protect the body from outside substances or anything that shouldn't be in the body. Unfortunately, the sensor that is helping you reach blood glucose levels is seen as an intruder in the body, so the immune system wants to attack and destroy it. However, the chemicals covering the glucose oxidase and the metal are what help protect them from the body. This is why the sensors need to be changed every few days, and also why it is important to change them on time. After the actual metal sensor is constructed, it is inserted into its base, including the needle that will inject it, and then is sterilized once more. Some modern sensors will also receive a factory calibration. This is where the sensor is dipped in a fluid with a known concentration of glucose, and then the people at the manufacturing plant look at the number the sensor reads and tag it with a certain code that will let the transmitter know whether the sensor reads a little high, a little low, or almost perfect, so the transmitter can make adjustments to help get better readings. Aside from the basic construction, there is one major difference between the glucose readings that a meter gives and those that a CGM gives. When you prick yourself to use a blood glucose meter, you are measuring the glucose in the blood. However, when a CGM is inserted, it goes into the interstitial fluid, which is the fluid that surrounds the cells. After digestion of the glucose from food, it first travels through the blood, but then it takes a little longer for it to absorb into the fluid between the cells. This means that CGM's readings will be delayed slightly after the glucose meter's readings. This is why you might see a higher number on your meter after you eat than on your CGM. This is because the glucose has arrived more in the blood than in the interstitial fluid. This can cause the CGM to be less accurate than the meter, which is why the CGMs need to be calibrated with readings from a meter to help maintain accuracy. Always calibrate them per the manufacturer's or your doctor's instructions. Although meters don't give perfect readings either, regular calibration will help ensure that your CGM remains as accurate as possible. However, even with calibration, the CGMs will still have some false readings. The programs that the transmitter uses are designed to help eliminate incorrect readings, but some will still slip by. If your CGM is giving you a reading that doesn't seem right, check with the meter so you can ensure that you're getting the most accurate readings possible. Aside from the sensor, the CGMs are a fairly simple piece of technology. The transmitter gets the data from the sensor, makes sure it seems correct, and then sends it to a receiver or smart device. To make sure that your CGM will keep working for you for as long as possible, make sure that you are treating it with the same amount of caution as you would an expensive piece of technology, because it is one. Transmitters and receivers can run anywhere from $500 to $2,000, and the sensors anywhere from $30 to $150 apiece. This high price is caused by the complex enzymes, precious metals, and many hours it takes to make a CGM sensor. Some insurance companies will cover a CGM, but they often like to see that you are controlling your blood sugars without one. This shows that you take your condition seriously and are actively treating it and would really benefit from a CGM. There will be times when your sensor or transmitter or receiver don't work. This is just part of using a CGM. CGM companies usually have tech support available to help assist you in getting it back up and running again. So next time you put on a CGM sensor, take a moment and think about how many hours of labor and new scientific technology that is allowing you to know your blood sugars and live a better, easier life.